Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are the NSAIDs, as the name itself indicates that these are the non-steroid drugs. That means they will not be having any physical dependence, and these are generally used for antipyretic effect, anti-inflammatory, as well as certain painlessness effect, that is analgesic effect. So what happens if I just want to give you an overview about this? Suppose we have a component known as arachidonic acid. Now this arachidonic acid give rise to prostaglandins. Now there are certain enzymes which will be catalyzing this reaction. These are known as cyclooxygenase. Now there are two types of cyclooxygenase which are responsible for formation of these prostaglandins, COX-1 and COX-2. Now there are certain drugs, suppose I'm giving a drug here, and this drug has equal effect on both of these enzymes. That's why it is known as non-selective. So one category will be non-selective COX inhibitors. Then we have certain drugs which will be having more effect on one and less effect on one. So one of the enzyme, and this is also one of the enzyme, it is having more effect on COX-2. So that means these will be also called as preferential COX inhibitors. Then we have the third category, which do not have any effect on the first, no effect is there, and there is effect only on the COX-2, that is the second type of enzyme. So these are known as selective COX-2 inhibitor. So we'll be dealing with the classification of these drugs on the basis of the enzyme they are inhibiting and how preferential they are to inhibit that particular enzyme. So first we have our first category, that is the non-selective COX inhibitors. So these are the cyclooxygenase inhibitor which will be inhibiting both COX-1 and COX-2 equally, having equal effect on these two. So first we have the salicylates, and this is the prototype of our particular this particular category, which is the traditional NSAIDs. So this aspirin, which is a salicylate, irreversibly inhibit these COX enzymes. Since it is irreversibly inhibiting, for further action and further formation of the PG, we require new COX, so that will be long active. So if we want to make new prostaglandins, we have to get new enzyme, so formation of new enzyme is required. So this is the only non-selective COX inhibitor which inhibits these enzymes irreversibly. Then we have second group, that is the propionic acid derivatives. These contain the ibuprofen. As we know, this is one of the most commonly used drug and comes with the brand name of Brufen, and this has been recently cleared by medical organizations for use in pediatric patients. So this drug can be used in pediatric patient, and this is very good anti-inflammatory drug. Then we have naproxen, generally used for gout patients, ketoprofen and flubiprofen. So these are the drugs which have propionic acid group on their chemical surfaces, and hence these are known as propionic acid derivatives. Then comes the phenamates. The third category is of phenamates, that is the mefenamic acid, and it is most commonly used for dysmenorrhea, and it is very effective. And this particular drug is as effective, having almost equal efficacy of that of opioids, but it does not have any physical dependence. So this is used by women for the menstrual pain. Then comes the enolic acid derivatives. So we have two, that is pyroxicam and tinoxicam, and these two drugs are long-acting NSAIDs. These are the long-acting NSAIDs, and these drugs are having a special type of metabolism known as enterohepatic circulation. And due to this is enterohepatic circulation, these drugs are long acting. So there was a question, which of the following is longest acting? The pyroxicam and tinoxicam can be taken as the answer. Now we have the fifth category, that is the acetic acid derivatives. We have ketorolac, indomethacin and nobimetone. So in the ketorolac, as we know, the ketorol DT we generally give, and this ketorolac is the NSAID which can be given IV. We have indomethacin, The important thing about this indomethacin is, first, it causes the frontal headache. And this particular drug, the indomethacin, is also known as the analgesic causing pain. So the side effect of this drug is it causes the headache or heaviness in the head, and hence it is also known as analgesic, that is the painkiller causing pain. Then we have nabumetone, which is a prodrug. So important thing about this nabumetone is it is a prodrug. Then we have the next group, that is the pyrazolone derivatives. We have phenylbutazone and oxyphenylbutazone in this particular category. So this is the first category. Now we have the second category. That is the preferential COX-2 inhibitors. That means they will be preferentially inhibiting the cyclooxygenase 2. So what are the drugs in this? We have nimesulide, diclofenac, aciclofenac, meloxicam and etodolac. In this, I can say that the nimesulide has been it is having very much hepatic toxicity. If it is given in too much amount, so it can cause a problem with the liver. Hence, it has been banned in several countries. And other drugs, diclofenac and aciclofenac, are still used. But the question arises, why we are discovering such preferential COX-2 inhibitor? What is the benefit of these drugs? So these drugs will be having less GIT complication. GIT complications are generally due to the COX-1 enzymes. So COX-1 enzymes will be making certain prostaglandins, and these prostaglandins are mucoprotective, that is the GIT protective prostaglandins. So COX-1 will be making certain prostaglandins, and these prostaglandins will protect the GIT. So these are the mucoprotective factors. So if we inhibit with certain drugs these COX-1, then these PG will not be generated, and hence GIT will be upset, leading to increase in acidity, or there can be chances of peptic ulcers in the GIT tract, or the ulcers in the whole GIT tract. So if we want to reduce the GIT side effect of the NSAIDs, then we have to let the COX-1 work. That's why they are preferentially inhibiting the COX-2, which is not associated with the GIT protection. So these drugs will be having less GIT side effects. Then we have selective COX-2 inhibitors. Now these selective COX-2 inhibitors will not be affecting COX-1 at all, and hence they will be totally protecting the GIT. So there will be much lesser GIT side effects due to COX-2 inhibitor. But still, there is certain problem with these drugs. The drugs in this category are celecoxib, etoricoxib and pericoxib. So you can remember these drugs by the word coxib. So all those drugs which are having coxib at their last, they will be in the COX-2 inhibitors. Now these drugs are found to have more myocardial complications. So they will be having cardiovascular disease. So chances of cardiovascular disease, myocardial infarction and all will be increased with the use of these drugs. That's why certain of the drugs have been banned also due to that particular complication. Then we have the fourth category, that is the analgesic antipyretics with poor anti-inflammatory action. So basically we know that the NSAIDs have all the three effects, that is the analgesic, antipyretic as well as the anti-inflammatory, but there are certain drugs which are not having anti-inflammatory drug, and if they are having anti-inflammatory effect, that effect will be poor. So we know that will be the most favorite of the doctors, paraaminophen phenol derivative, that is the paracetamol, or we all also call this particular drug as acetaminophen, and tinolol also the name. This drug is also coming with the name of tinolol. So then we have the pyrazolone derivative, that is the metamizole and dipyrone and propiphenazone. Then we have benzoxazone derivative, that is nifopam. So these are less important. The most important drug here which we have to discuss is paracetamol, also known as the acetaminophen. We'll be discussing all these drugs. Cyclooxygenase Now these are the enzymes which will be converting the arachnoid acid into the PGs. Now there are generally two types, but another third type has been found from the cerebral cortex, and it is recently isolated from the cortex, so that is also having certain function. So first, talking of the cyclooxygenase 1, this is the enzyme which is always present, that is, it is constitutive, it is always present in the cells, and it will be helping in housekeeping functions of the body. That means it will be protecting the body, body's inner membranes. So this is having certain mucoprotective function, secreting the prostaglandins, which will be protecting the gastric lining. Now, if you talk about the COX-2, now these COX-2 are inducible. That means they have to be synthesized and stimulated by certain endotoxins or some other inflammatory mediators to act. Now, as we know that if there is an attack by some endotoxin or there are certain inflammatory mediators, they will be activating this COX-2, and hence it will be producing certain prostaglandins which will be taking part in inflammatory reactions. Now, the drugs which will be inhibiting this COX-2 will be called anti-inflammatory. So this is that simple. Now, if I talk about the constitutive presence of these COX-2 enzymes, they are constitutively present in brain, endothelium and kidney. Now these COX-2 are also pro-carcinogenic. That means they will be inhibiting the apoptosis. So apoptosis is the body protective function, which is also known as the self suicide of the cell, and it protects the body from the carcinogenesis process. Now what happens if the COX-2 and enzymes are there, they will be inhibiting the activity of the apoptosis and hence will be increasing the chances of carcinogenesis. So these drugs will be acting as enzymes will be acting as pro-carcinogenic. Then we have the COX-3. As I have already told, that it is recently isolated from the cerebral cortex and it is involved in pain as well as fever. So it is involved in the analgesia, and if we are giving the COX-3 inhibitory drug, then it will be causing the analgesia and antipyresis, but no anti-inflammation. So it is not involved in the inflammation, and the drug which is favorite for all the doctors is paracetamol, which targets the COX-3. Now, as we have already discussed, that aspirin is an irreversible inhibitor of COX. So it inhibits COX irreversibly, and it is the only drug of its category which is inhibiting the COX irreversibly, and hence it has to be returned to the function, this particular COX, if it wants to be returned to its own function, so it cannot come into the function, so we require the synthesis of fresh enzyme to have the production of the prostaglandins, which are inhibited by the aspirin if it is inhibiting the COX. So how it inhibits? It acetylates the serine residues of this particular COX enzyme and inhibits its irreversibility. Now other drugs, other NSAIDs are competitive and reversible inhibitors of COX, means they won't be inhibiting it irreversibly, but there are chances that if the drug dissociates from the enzyme, then the function of that particular enzyme can be refreshed and activity will be again done. So that all, when and how it will be done, it will be all dependent on the pharmacokinetic characteristic of the compound. So the basic thing and the key point here is that the question in exam can be asked, which of the following inhibits the COX enzymes irreversibly? The answer to that question will be aspirin, because all other NSAIDs are competitive and reversible inhibitors of the COX. Let's talk about the enzymes and their effect on different their particular actions. If we have COX-1 and COX-2 inhibitors with us, that means if the drugs are not preferential or selective, they are non-selective, then they will be inhibiting either COX-1 or COX-2. Now these drugs will be having analgesic action, because that will be inhibiting the prostaglandins, then antipyretic action, anti-inflammatory, anti-platelet aggregatory. When I talk about the platelet aggregatory, the prostaglandin responsible for this is prostaglandin I2 and thromboxane A2. Now this PGI2 is anti-aggregatory, while this thromboxane A2 is pro-aggregatory. Now if we are inhibiting the COX, then formation of this thromboxane A2 will be decrease, as well as this particular PGI2 will also be decreased. But there is more prominent effect on thromboxone A2. That means anti-aggregative, pro-aggregation, it should be opposite of that if we are inhibiting this enzyme. If we are inhibiting thromboxane A2, pro-aggregation will be opposed, and hence the more effect will be anti-aggregative. So the net sum of the effect of inhibiting both these prostaglandins will be anti-aggregatory, that means antiplatelet aggregatory. So this is a very important point to remember for the exam point of view. Then we have gastric mucosal damage. Yes, that is basically due to COX-1. That's the reason we are making preferential and selective COX-2 inhibitors, because the gastric mucosal damage, if we are inhibiting the COX-1, that will be causing the decrease in the mucoprotective factors, and hence will cause gastric mucosal damage. So again, COX-1 inhibitors are basically responsible for GIT side effects of the NSAIDs. Then we have renal salt water retention. Yes. Then we have prolongation of labor. Yes. Why? Yes. Because the prostaglandins, if I generally talk about the uterine, then PGE2 as well as PGF2 alpha, these are responsible for uterine contraction. Now we are giving inhibitors. Yes, we are giving COX-1 and COX-2 inhibitors. So it will be inhibiting the production of these two, prostaglandins, which are responsible for contraction of the uterine contraction, and hence there will be delay or prolongation of labor. Then we have ductus arteriosus closure. What happens? We give generally aspirin in combination with indomethacin to close this ductus arteriosus. Okay, so COX-1 plus COX-2, that is both the inhibitors in the combination will be having certain effect, and there is no known effect, no known use till now for COX-2 inhibitors. Then we'll have aspirin sensitive asthma precipitation. Yes, aspirin, if given to the asthmatic patient, that will be precipitating the asthma in them, and hence COX-1, COX-2, non-selective drugs like aspirin should not be given in such patients which are having asthma. So let me compare this. If what are the benefits of using only COX-2 inhibitors? They will be having analgesic action. Yes, they will be having antipyretic action. Yes, they will be having anti-inflammatory action. Means all the three basic actions which we are having from the NSAIDs will be coming from COX-2 inhibitors also. Then antiplatelet aggregatory won't be prominent there by the COX-2. Then gastric mucosal damage will not be there, and this is very beneficial. This is a useful thing for us, because COX-1 is responsible for mucoprotective. If we are not inhibiting the COX-1, just inhibiting COX-2 alone, then gastric mucosal damage, that is the side effect of NSAID, will not be there. Then renal salt water reaction, it will be having the same effect. Then delay or prolongation level, yes, it will be also inhibiting the PGE2 and FGF2 alpha, and hence will be delaying the prolongation of labor. Then ductus arteriosus closure is generally seen with aspirin and indomethacin, basically with the non-selective COX inhibitor. With COX-2 inhibitors, such things have not been yet tested, or these are not confirmed yet. Now aspirin sensitive asthma, again non-selective COX inhibitors will be precipitating the asthma in the patient, while in COX-2 selective inhibitors there won't be such precipitation of the asthma. So before I go ahead with all this thing, let me summarize the production of PG, that is the prostaglandins. Suppose this is the phospholipid membrane. This phospholipid membrane is converted into arachidonic acid by an enzyme known as PLPA2, and this arachidonic acid will be acted upon by two types of enzyme. One is lipoxygenase and another is cyclooxygenase. Right now we are talking about the cyclooxygenase. So this cyclooxygenase will be acting on this and will be producing PGG2 or H2, and this PGG2 and H2 is highly unstable, which will be converted later into PG, prostaglandin D2, prostaglandin E2, and prostaglandin F2 alpha. Then we have PGI2, that is the anti-aggregatory prostaglandin, And then we have thromboxane A2, which is a pro-aggregatory prostaglandins. Now what happens, we should again remember this, this thromboxane A2 is produced by the platelets. And these platelets do not have any nucleus. And since no nucleus is there with thromboxane A2, once they are inhibited by our NSAIDs, then it is very difficult to get their use again, let them revive again. So what happens, they are permanently inhibited and the new thromboxane are required to show further pro-aggregatory effect. That's why they are having more effect on thromboxane A2 rather than PGI2, which are having the nucleus and can be synthesized again and again and revive again and again. So that's why the NSAIDs are having more effect on the thromboxane A2 and hence acts as anti-platelet aggregatory drugs. Now let's discuss certain frequently asked questions based on the NSAIDs. So first we have just discussed about the classification and certain general effects of the COX enzymes. So the question here asks is, which NSAID undergoes enterohepatic circulation? As I have already discussed in the notes itself, the enterohepatic circulation, if it is there, then it will be making the drugs more long acting. So the drugs like tinoxicam and pyroxicam are long acting drugs, and the answer to this will be the pyroxicam. So the next question here is, COX pathway is inhibited by all except. So the keyword here will be the COX pathway, COX cyclooxygenase pathway, and it is asking the wrong statement. So all of these inhibit the COX except one. Which one is the lucky one? So the first one is the aspirin. As we know, aspirin is the non-selective COX-1 as well as COX-2 inhibitor. So this cannot be the answer. Then we have indomethacin. This is also, as we have seen in the classification, this is also an NSAID. And then we have the diclofenac D. This is also NSAID, and they are not inhibiting. These all three, A, B, and D, are non-selective COX inhibitor. And the one C, that is the beta methasone, is not the COX pathway inhibitor, hence the answer is C.